sorrow inside. Praise the Lord, I saw the light. So happy, no sorrow inside. Praise the Lord, I saw the light.
Thank you, Millie. Good morning, everybody. Welcome to Unity Temple in the Plaza, a place where diversity is praised and peace and harmony are the rewards. I welcome you all here today. And how are you doing? I haven't seen you for a long time. She used to work here, and a good friend. It's nice to see you. And also, Jackie is back. For those of you who don't know her, every October or November, she goes off to France by herself, comes back 6 months later. Stand up and let them see. All by herself. She's 90-some years old. And she's still traveling the world. Yeah. Good to see you. Anyway, I have a few announcements before we begin the service. I have quite a few, actually. Today, for the first time in 2.5 years, maybe 2 years, I guess, we are going to open community time up after the service. So if you want to go down for coffee and snacks or something downstairs, meet some of your fellow people in this community, that would be great. We invite you down. Also, Rory, who's speaking today, Rory Hutt is his name, and he's going to be down there. He's new to this congregation on the ministerial path. He's going to be a minister someday. So we look forward to hearing what he has to say, and come downstairs afterward to say hello. We have a concert coming up May 15th. This honors the Kansas City Women of Jazz. Geneva Price is one of the honorees that's going to receive an award. Yep. And we're pleased about that. We have an early bird special on tickets. They're $20 off. You can buy them in the lobby if you like. Or you can go on the website or to Eventbrite and pick them up at some other time. Helping Hands Day is today. We have bags that you can take with you. And as you're driving home or going about your way, just give them to one of the people on the corners that needs substantials. And it needs some of the very basics. It has food in there. It has stuff to keep them warm. It has a little first aid kit and some other things that just daily necessities that people need. So they're out there. They're in the blue bags. Take one, take two, take as many as you want. That happens on the first Sunday of every month. And Mother's Day is coming up. And I forget what the date is. Is it next Sunday? Yeah, next Sunday. Well, we always do a Mother's Day slideshow. So if you have pictures of your mother, send them in, and you can see it on the big screen. If your mother's still alive and she's in this area, bring her to church and surprise her with her picture up on the big screen. It's always great. Some of the pictures are mothers that have been long gone for many years, and others are the newest younger mothers that just had their first child. So I think that is the end of these announcements. I can't think of anything. I don't know. I'm not used to doing announcements all the time. So that being said, let's move into the service with the Temple Chimes, the opening prayer, and Geneva Price with the call to inspiration. Please say this with me if you choose. Together, on this day, we dedicate ourselves to peace on earth. We accept ourselves without harsh judgment and express appreciation for our individuality. We live without fear to meet the events of this day with confidence. We accept others without prejudice to experience a sense of unity with all people. We honor our earthly environment and recognize a oneness with all creation in harmony with ourselves, our lives, other people, and all of nature. We live this day with a peaceful mind, a peaceful heart, and a peaceful spirit. Thank you, God. Amen.
Today I affirm God's Spirit within me, at worship, at work, in struggle, in rest. God's Spirit inspires all life, which is changing from fearing to faith, from broken to blessed. For I am protected by God's loving care. The long and winding road that leads to your door will never disappear. I've seen that road before. It always leads me here, leads me to your door. The wild and windy night that the wind washed away has left a pool of tears, crying for the dead. Don't leave me standing here. Let me the many ways I've tried, and still that lead me back to the long and winding road. You left me standing here a long, long time. I've been alone, and many times I've cried. Anyway, you'll never know the many ways I've tried, and still they lead me back to the long and winding road. You left me standing here a long, long time ago. Oh,
preparing for my talk today, I've had some amazing encounters here at the temple, just in conversations, walking around. And one of those conversations today was on judgment. And part of that is the judgment of yourself on where you should be. Because the title of my talk is, Where You Need to Be, You Are. How many of us have felt at different times we need to be someplace other than where we're at? Maybe it's economically, we're looking at life and we feel like, at this age, I feel like I should have been somewhere else. Or maybe spiritually, we feel, wow, where am I at right now? I work in the death care industry, and I can't tell you the number of times that I'm around people that they just don't really feel confident with what comes next. A lot of insecurity, a lot of questions about the life that they've lived of, did I live up to my potential? Was there some other life that I should have lived? Maybe it's a comparison. We live in a society where there's a lot of things pulling us in a lot of different directions, a lot of distractions. So I really want to explore that with you guys today. Now, as a young man, and I'm sure many of you have had this experience, we're going along a path in life. And spiritually, we are at a point where we need to be when we need to be there. And I can't emphasize that enough, because sometimes you'll encounter someone who is maybe 80 years old, and you look at them and say, how could they be living their life some particular way? Because we're placing an expectation of what their life should be like. Maybe we see a 30-year-old, and they seem to be a little bit further along. Wherever you are is perfect, because it's your own journey, and it can never be anyone else's. As a young kid, I was living in rural Missouri in a trailer that wasn't necessarily a very nice trailer. And looking back, I see it differently than going through it. Because I'm sure all of us have had that experience that we're going through life and it doesn't feel the best. But looking back, we're like, wow, that was a great experience that I had. I'm glad that it happened exactly as it did. So foresight might not always be the best. They say hindsight's 20/20. So as I'm telling you part of this story, it's with a sense of gratitude because everything happened exactly as it needed to be for me to be here with you. And out of 7 billion people on earth, to be here in this room with you guys, the chances of that happening is so slim. And in every experience of your life, that's how it is. The chances of you being there is so unique, it's so special. But are we missing it, or are we spending time someplace else in our mind other than where we're at? So I want to read to you from this book. It's called Spiritual Unfoldment. And this book came to me, I was a kid in eighth grade, as most eighth graders are reading books on spirituality. I'm living about 20 miles outside of town in rural Missouri, to where my friends are a couple of goats and a turkey named Tom. And I'm just kind of lost, because I'm looking at my life, which at that point in time, we didn't have a lot of food. We didn't have a lot of options necessarily, or I didn't perceive myself having a lot of options. And so I kind of did a lot of comparison. I look at other people's lives and I think, man, what would it be like just to have a car that when we're at school and mom gets in to turn the keys that it actually starts? I don't really know what that experience would be, because I'd be out there and sometimes the car didn't start. So then I'm feeding all these stories in my life of what life should be like. Then this wonderful woman by the name of Esther came my way. And Esther, one thing that always fascinated me about her, she had all these Unity books. I didn't know what Unity was. I didn't know where all these books had come from that she had collected. But looking back over life, I have this great sense of gratitude that she was there. Now, when I met her, she was too old for me to really engage in some in-depth conversation. But she did the right things at the right time. And there's an expression that we might have heard of at some point in time or another that says, when the student's ready, the teacher will appear. How many of us have heard that before? And so in life, as you're going through it, you're always a teacher and you're always a student, because there will always be people who need you to show up. And that's so important. The challenges you're going through may not be for you. They may be for someone who's waiting for you to show up. Then are you willing to show up? But don't always put pressure on yourself saying, I have to be the one to deliver for this person. Because maybe that person that you feel you are there to help is there to teach you a particular lesson. So in this book, Spiritual Unfoldment, there's one paragraph that really stood out to you, or stood out to me, and it said, many of you have returned to earth because you want to help humanity, not necessarily by going to church and doing good works, but because your very presence in life can be a joy and comfort to those about you. Give warmth and light to help each flower bloom its best in the particular patch of garden in which it's planted. So I really want to elaborate on that a little bit, or explore that. And as I go through this, I always want you to know that I don't have all of the answers. I only have my perception based off of my own experience. And what you hear, and this is really important to know, how do I attend a service? How do I attend church? Well, number one, be a student. Be seeking for the story that's right for you. Because it's not going to be a universal principle. And if I come up here and I'm saying, this is the way you need to live your life, well, that's a folly, because you need to live your life the best that you can based off of your own principles. When you see someone out there, sometimes it's our tendency, and I'm very involved with children. They pull at my heart, because I remember Esther showing up with the right books at the right time. And I think to myself, when I see this child who's struggling in life, how can I become a better teacher so that I can help place the right things in their life? Now, I don't want to remove them from the situation that they're in, but how can I equip them to move forward in their life with a higher level of understanding? And Esther, all that she did was she collected the books. She passed away. My mom had this pile of books on the floor, and I'm going through these times in this trailer, and I'm just like, I just want things to be different. Pick up this book, and it says, wherever you're at, it's okay, because this is where you need to be in your path. But how can you help other people? And so throughout this journey, I've always thought, how can I show up with new lessons for this individual? Or if I see the child, how can I help them believe in themselves more of where they're at? Because there's always someone going through suffering. And sometimes we think to ourselves, this isn't the way that the world should be. And we'll be justifying that it's based off of politics. I'm going to go through a little bit of a blame list here. Politics, right? Taxes are too high. Church isn't what it used to be. How many of us have heard those types of reasons? Education system, now that's a big one. The education system isn't what it used to be. And I really clung to this list. And then I pick up this book by Orson Sweet Martin that was written in the 1900s. And then I see that old saying, blameless, that it's the politics, taxes are too high, things are harder now than they've ever been. And what he says in there is that we all have this human potential to go down the path to be a student and a teacher in every given circumstance. So when you look at the child and you think, what am I here to do? Am I here to remove them from their situation, or can I help grant them some new clarity? How in your story there's some gem of truth, some gem that's true for you? Because universal truths are not truths, because some people will say, this is the way you need to live, is you need to go to church, you need to do this to have a good life. It's your life, and it's okay. And we love you, and we appreciate you exactly as you are. So looking at it from a place of understanding, realizing that you're always a student and you are a teacher. Now, some of our teachers may be that 3-year-old who's 80-year-old in spirit, and it might be the 80-year-old who's, you know, 15. But don't be judgmental. They're exactly where they need to be when they need to be there. How can you help them grow? So perhaps it's early on in the walk. Some of you might be a little bit further along. It's not a matter of time that determines the distance that you've traveled. So if you are on this later part of your life, maybe you feel like you're 50, 60, life's not over. You're still here. There's something more for you to do, and you need to feel that inside of you. I go into meetings sometimes, maybe it's a rotary meeting, and they just feel like, well, I'm just going to show up. And it's like, no, you're still here. So you're here in this movement, Unity, for your growth, but also someone else is waiting for you to show up. There's so many people right now that are just confused. They're like, is there any place that I belong? I was raised in this particular religious belief, but this doesn't resonate with you. That's okay. Unity is a place, come how you are. No one has the ultimate truth for you. You're on your own unique journey. Are you going to give yourself permission to do that? Not, well, at this point in time, this is where you need to be. Now, I work in the death care industry. I can tell you what happens at the end. No matter what you do, you're going to end up there. And so whatever you do is fine. You grow forward. So know this, the right messages come to you at the right time in the right way. So when you hear the speaker, ask, what is the lesson for me here to learn? Sit there with a notebook and say, what is here? Because you should be able to listen to any type of speaker, whether it be a Unity minister, whether it be a Buddhist teacher, or whether it be someone who somehow you ended up in, let's say, a Pentecostal church, and you're not familiar with the Pentecostal religion necessarily, and and something's, I can't listen to this person because of a blank. Or maybe it's a racist and you're like, I'm not racist. Well, can you seek out a lesson in there? Now, you may have huge conflicts in there, but is there something that you can glean from that experience of how not to be? You see the homeless person out on the street, say, they shouldn't be homeless. Are you sure? Are we being loving right now, or are we being judging? When we think of the journey of Jesus, and if Jesus, when I say that to you, it incites something to you, you're like, oh my goodness, someone's up on a Unity stage and talking about Jesus, what is it in your story that has caused you to feel a particular way about the name of Jesus? And if that bothers you, go down that journey and say, well, where did I pick this up from? Like, what is this that doesn't resonate with you? Because I'm pretty sure Jesus was the type of guy where he was seeking out the Christ understanding in his life, and then once he found that, he came back into the world and said, hey, you've got it in you. He didn't say, come worship me up on the stage or anything else like that. He was just exposing people to that Christ within, that journey that they're all on. Now, did everyone like it? No, as we can tell. But some people did, the right people at the right time. The Unity ministers, I mean, there's so many phenomenal teachers out there in the world. It's not Unity, it's not necessarily just Christianity, it's not anything. It's the teachers are there if you are the right student. And I believe there was a guy named Matthew. At some point in time, it was a pretty popular book, and he had a expression in there that I want to go through with you. And I'm pretty sure that it said, seek and ye shall find. Have we heard that before? And so sometimes in life we'll show up and we're come to the world with our problems. But I'm pretty sure that the story said, seek and ye shall find, ask and it shall be given, right? Knock and the door shall open. But if I come to the world and tell you, I really feel that things are messed up. Is that asking new questions, or is that just coming to justify? Because as soon as your mind focuses on something, what's it gonna start doing? Justifying what it is you're looking for. If you say, well, how do I provide more love to the world? Guess what will start showing up in your life? Teachers, lessons. You've now opened yourself up to become a student of life. Some people's cups are overflowing. Have we been out there, then we've seen people that seem to just know everything about everything? And so, don't be that person. You're always teacher and you're always student. If you find yourself in an environment you're having conflicts, be willing to ask the questions, what is this here to teach me? What is the lesson that I can learn from this? And I want to look at the age and experience of these lessons sometimes. I was at a father-son camp last year with my son. I thought, this is a great bonding experience. I'm going to be able to go out here and engage with my son, do some activities. And so we go on an ATV ride, which is fantastic. We do some paintball, and part of this was a Christian camp, because I was looking for a Unity father-son camp, but that's not out there. I was looking for something that didn't have such a strong tie to any particular religious belief, but we're out there, and so I understand that there's going to be lessons as part of this venture that my son and I are on. So we've done our bonding, and then it comes time for the fathers to go to the group for the lesson. So I'm there, and I said, son, you go over there and you be the best son you can be. Go have fun with the other kids. I'm going to go over here and give this lesson. So I show up in this room, and I'm engaging with the other fathers. And as I'm there with them, I realize that each one of these individuals are having their own unique experience. There's no correct. There's no incorrect. Because in life, you can either be loving or you can be judging. Now, so I'm there, and I'm writing in my notebook. I said, be a student, be a student, be a student, Rory. Be open. Be receiving. And then the speaker begins to speak, and he says, we need to have the serious conversations with our children. So I write down, okay, serious conversations with children. I'm like, okay, got this. And then he says, we need to talk to our kids about being loving. So I said, okay, be loving, express loving. Then he says, and we need to speak the truth. And I said, okay, speak the truth. Okay. Then he continues on about the hard things in life, about the hard things in life. Okay, got it. So I'm going to go talk to my son about the hard things in life. Then he says, you need to be loving, but you got to speak the truth. And things about homosexuality. I'm like, oh man, here we go. Okay, speak the truth. Sorry, I get out of there. Like, my mind gets hung up at that point in time. He probably says some incredible things in there, but I was lost at that point in time, because I thought, are we being loving or are we being judging? And I said, okay, so I get out of there. I'm like, okay, now this is the opportunity I get to have this father-son bonding moment. So we're out there on the sidewalk. It's a cloudy day. I put my hand on my son's shoulder. And I said, son, we need to talk about the tough things. He's like, what tough things? I said the tough things, son, because you got to have that right kind of tonality as a parent. Like, son, we're going to have this conversation. And so my son says, what tough conversation? I said, son, like things like homosexuality. He's like, we already talk about that stuff, Dad. I said, no. Let's talk about the serious stuff. And he said, we need to speak the truth. And he said, whose truth? And at that moment, tear came to my eye. I said, I love you, son. Because whose truth are we basing this off of? In this journey of life, it's a matter of seeking your own truth. In spirituality, it's about finding your own truth. That's where unity came about. Because so many people, if you listen to their spiritual story, it's very rigid. It says, this is the way it is supposed to be. Then people get out of there and they're like, oh, that's not me. That just didn't resonate with me. And so I have a lot of conversations with people. And they say, well, that just wasn't me. Well, what is you? Have you explored that? And I'm not to say this is the way that you need to be, but it's your own walk. And so when they're in that point, and they say, I don't really know go explore that, because it's okay to explore your own truth. And don't beat up on yourself, because you're exactly where you need to be at this point in time. The perception that you have of life has become because of every experience up till now. Yeah, life in the book, The Road Less Traveled by M. Scott Peck, it says the first line, does anyone know it? Life is tough. Then you can put the rest of the book down. It's a big book. You don't have to read the entire thing. But if you already expect life is tough, how do we move forward with that understanding? Can we shift our perspective on what tough is? Because life's already happened. And this is huge, is when you're looking back over the story of your life, you gain these new understandings. And Wayne Dyer said it well. He said, we're not human beings having a spiritual experience. We're spiritual beings having a human experience. Then also, he has another thing that he's famous for saying, which is, it's never too late for a happy childhood. Do some of us have some experience or know of somebody who has had a perceived challenge in their childhood or in their youth and their upbringing? And as you gain these new insights, don't be afraid to go venture back into the past. You still need to be here present, but if you have things weighing you down from the past, it is very difficult to move forward with some level of understanding. So as you pick up the new tool, as you pick up the new idea, look back over your life. Because in the mess, sometimes it's like, if you only knew how rough life has been, are you looking for the things that are rough, or can you start finding the great things in there? Well, what was awesome? Well, I was born. I mean, that's a great start to any life story. I'm pretty sure any great biography of the world began the same way that yours did. You were born. And here's the next part is, you're not dead yet, because we're here having this conversation. And so you still have room to grow, to adapt, and to change so that the story becomes the way that you want it to. If you're still moving forward and it is very heavy, this stuff that's happened in the past, go back and reframe it. Look at what was great in this life story. What were some of the gems that I've picked up? And who is it that needs me to show up in life? Is everyone there for you? Not necessarily. But what if it's just one person? Because I think of Esther, and I'm like, no one in here knows who that woman was. There's another woman named Dorothy Johnson. She lived in Cortland, Kansas. She was my mom's therapist in the 70s. And she's the one who introduced me to Unity. What happened? I'm like at this dark point in life, and I'm thinking, I need a new teacher. And that kind of led me here as well. But as I was there and I was seeking out a new teacher, my mom said, hey, there's this woman. She sent the Daily Word to our house, which was Unity publication, still is Unity publication. And I thought, I'm just going to write a letter to Cortland, Kansas, Dorothy Johnson. So leap of faith, send a letter out there. I'm seeking the new teacher. And then I didn't know her address, sent it in the mail. And then a few weeks later, I get this letter in the mail. She says, I'm 87, I can't travel. She starts sending me these boxes of books that she's collected, and she said, hey, I don't know where you're at in your journey. You know, I wish I could come and see you, but maybe in this, you'll find the right lesson you're seeking at the right time. I thought, dang, these amazing women I've not really been able to spend any time with left the right kind of things for the right kind of students. So it doesn't matter where you're at. It doesn't matter if you're 80, if you're 70, if you're 40 or 30, The right teachers are waiting. If you become the right kind of student, if you start seeking out the answers, that guidance will be there. But you move from this place where you're at, which is perfect, because for us to be having this conversation, a lot of things had to happen. And I appreciate it all. And you have to appreciate your own journey, because it's unique. Someone will grow from that. Even if it's not within this lifetime that someone picks up on the gems that you've left behind, your story is important, and it's meaningful. So always know it's an inward journey of outward expression. So as you're venturing inward, as you're taking in this new information, realize that it's an inward journey. The spiritual teachers, and this is huge, because sometimes there's conflict that arises because people say, this particular type of religion doesn't resonate with me, is that every spiritual teacher, whether it be Jesus or Buddha, any of the many, there's been a lot of spiritual teachers, and each one of them will have something for you if you're looking for it. If you're looking for why it doesn't resonate with you, just turn to your neighbor, have a conversation with them. You'll find some things in their life story that you don't like, some belief systems that you don't like. Or you can seek out, well, what is this here to teach me? How do I grow from this? Every spiritual teacher will teach you it's an inward journey that you ultimately have to take. They are there to show you to a certain point, but eventually, if we give all of our power away, we will really struggle with connecting and growing forward. But when you truly embark upon that path of where you're at, it's going to be an inward journey. So as you pick up new things, realize that everything is moving you inward, and that's where you're going to find the best answers. I don't have any answers. I just have a few different life experiences and some amazing spiritual teachers that have shown up for me throughout time. I hope to engage with each one of you and learn from your stories, because I know each one of you are teachers. Each one of you are brilliant beyond anything that I have inside of me. But also, as you're engaging with each other, understand that everyone's got something to teach you, even if it's someone to where I absolutely struggle with what they're saying or who they are as an individual. One more lesson from that is you're either loving or you're judging in every single experience. So when you look at the challenges of life, because we're all going through challenges in different ways, but we're also blessed at the same time, are you expressing judgment or are you expressing love? Because imagine that if everyone expressed love in everything they do, even looking at themselves in their own life without any form of judgment, how much more fulfilled you could be, and how much more you could reach out to everyone in your life to deeply impact them in a positive direction. So when we're watching the news, it pulls us maybe into a sense of judgment of the world shouldn't be this kind of way. I look at my life and I realize, or I feel, that this isn't where I should be right now. Can you look at that with more of a sense of loving and saying, how amazing is it that I can sit here at this moment and perceive life in the way that I do? And what did it take for me to be here right now? And that's okay. And that you're loved. And I want you to really feel that in the essence of your being, because it doesn't matter who says what on the stage. It's a matter of how you inwardly reflect upon what they are saying. And so if there's something that ever causes discourse in your life, go back to look at that with more of a sense of love, because that's ultimately what all of the spiritual teachers were there to teach us, is how to be more loving of ourselves, of others, and how to be that expression out there in the world. Now, is the world perfect? That's debatable. But is there something that's perfect going on right now? And you can either focus on that or you can focus on what makes you feel less comfortable. But just know that it's your journey. You're exactly where you need to be right now at the right time for the right person, whether that be you or someone else around you. But be willing to go on that venture. Continue on that journey forward. Realize it's an inward venture for outward expression. And so thank you all for allowing me to be here with you at this moment. Hopefully there was something in there for you, and if not, maybe it rose conflict and you're like, that guy just sounds crazy. That's okay too. Find the lesson in there, seek it out. Thank you.
Consciousness, a state of peacefulness, and
And after moving into meditation, take a moment to get comfortable in your seat. And just for a moment or two, we're going to focus on our breathing. So breathe in and hold it for just a moment. And then slowly exhale. Once again, breathing in, breathing out. With each breath, we find ourselves getting more and more relaxed, going deeper and deeper into the very inner core of our being, into the heart of our being, where all the worldly distractions disappear. All the complaints and criticisms disappear. All the trials and trouble go away. And we have this time in the sacred silence to just contemplate whatever comes into our mind without grasping onto it or holding it. Let it pass by like a cloud in the sky. And we return to focusing on our breath. It's often said that life is a teacher and we are the students. But oftentimes we seem to think that we are the graduates, that we know what should happen next. We know how the world should be. We know how other people should be. But life is a process for each of us individually. Right now, in this moment, there's almost 9 billion people living in their own reality. 9 billion people in the world, 9 billion realities, each one valid and just as important as any other one. For each of us, our reality can be in a stuck position. It is what it is, and it's not going to change. And if it's working for you, that is great. But then oftentimes reality can be difficult. Hurtful emotions can arise. We can fall into conflict with other people. We feel like life has no meaning, it has no purpose, it has no end. Our life can be a blank page, waiting for you to write your reality on it, to picture it in your mind, to feel it in your heart. And even though it isn't appearing outside of you in this moment, hold the vision and move towards it. We now move into the silence to rest and restore, rejuvenate and rejoice in the silence. ever so slowly bring ourselves back for meditation. And we do so with awareness that peace is the most important thing we desire. Harmony is our most natural state. And love is the greatest experience we can have in this dimension. Peace, harmony, and love. And with that, we go forward with a peaceful mind, a peaceful heart, and a peaceful spirit. We say, thank you, God. Amen.
Something within me that holdeth the reins, something within me that banishes pain, something within me I cannot explain. All that I know, there is something within. Whatever you may do in life, you're gonna need somebody to stand by you. Wherever you may go, you may go. to stand by you.
Thank everybody for making this a wonderful Sunday. Robert, it's always good to have you here. Millie, fantastic. And Rory Hutt, thank you for your first time here. I've enjoyed it, and you did a good job. Rory's also going to be teaching a class on forgiveness beginning this Thursday. It's from 6:30 to 8, I believe. Yeah, downstairs in space, it's on a love offering basis. It's a four-week series. You can attend one of the classes, or all four if you'd like. But I think he has a lot to offer this congregation, and I hope we see more of him. Yes. Now, we had planned this service for most of the week, so everything would end perfectly at 11:30. And the kids from the youth education department were supposed to be up here right now. And as soon as Millie was done, Robert was going to play Walking in the Light, and all the kids were going to come in. I don't know where they're at. It's best laid plans, but I can see them screening around someplace, or they just don't care. They say, no, we want to finish our coloring. So what else we got? Pardon me? I don't think they're out there. I don't see them, unless they're really little. Anybody out there? Okay, they're here. Walking in the light. Just as a reference, the Angel Loft, the little babies, there's three times the number of kids that are up here, so the future looks great for Unity. Well, now I'll say the prayer for protection and then sing the peace song together. The light of God surrounds us. The love of God enfolds us. The power of God protects us. The presence of God watches over us. Wherever we are, God is, and all is well. Visit us downstairs. Come down and say hi to Rory. We'll now sing the peace song.